In the season when the desert wind goes from hot to not so hot, a certain feeling begins to overtake the night, especially in those leftover towns the old-timers said were haunted, or even the folks of today for that matter. I don't know what it is about a legit 1800s ghost town that draws out the spirits, but I guarantee you this place has some stories. We out here in the sticks of Arizona don't have fancy haunted houses like they have out California way. Out here we like our frights raw, like the leather off the neck of a Vulture City miner.
Hey there folks, it's Glenn with the Cactus Atlas coming at you with a special Halloween episode as we explore the world of Gourdy Ghouligan's Halloween Spooktacular. So on today's episode, we're going to just take you around and see what 2023 has to offer here at Vulture City this year. We're regular returning customers. We've been doing this for several years now, and we never miss it. But to keep things interesting this time, Vulture City is known to be a very haunted place, and I'm going to take you around as we experience the works of Villafane Studios and tell you some of the real ghost stories here at Vulture City. So Amy and I have been coming out here for years at this point, at various times when they used to do this back in Carefree, Arizona, for those of you that remember. But doing this in the Vulture City setting is just what the doctor ordered, especially in a town reported to be as haunted as something like Vulture City. And Amy and I are not really doing a ghost adventures lockdown style thing, but we are gonna go poke our heads in some of the areas that they say are haunted. And even, it's a lot darker out here right now than this looks to you, but they've got this thing lit up just perfectly. It's just, lights are starting to pop on, and I am in love with the aesthetic of this piece. You get that whimsical Villafane Studios look and feel, built on what you would assume is a real period relic, like this old truck. And you got a skull to boot.
Territorial Arizona, back in the 1860s, was not the world's most forgiving place. Prospectors like Henry Wickenburg, founder of the Vulture Mine, worked within a context where violence and vigilantism was how things got done sometimes. When old Henry named his discovery the Vulture Mine way back in 1863, he probably didn't think his claim would result in up to 5,000 souls coming along for the ride at its peak. The Vulture Mine is arguably the most important gold mine in Arizona history, even spurring the development of the city we know as Phoenix today. Yeah, there's lots of history at Vulture City. There's little arguing that. Must be why they also have so many dang ghosts.
All right, Amy, are you ready to go tell ghost stories and see the amazing works of Ray Villafane up close? All right, so we have to head over to the old ghost town. Vulture City, baby. Sorry, I stole someone else's thing, didn't I?
Yes, you did.
So as we make our way down in here, Amy, this is a place you and I know very well. We've talked about it before. We made many videos here at Vulture City, and we've seen this place in its truest ghost town form, I would argue, a decade or more ago when this place was just rubble.
Yeah, I think there was only maybe two houses or two buildings that were in any kind of shape.
Yeah, and now you and I knew even back then that this place was very reported to be haunted, and we experienced in those lonelier days. What do you feel any weirdness here? You and I have been here when there's nobody around and we've been in buildings by ourselves. Do you ever feel like someone's looking over your shoulder here? When you've explored at any time, and you know, over the years,
looking over my shoulder, no. But in the past, whenever I go into the brothel, I do feel dizzy. But
interesting, and that's supposed to be.
I don't believe in that kind of thing, so I don't.
Well, yeah, you and I have both expressed that before. We're skeptics, but even as skeptics, sometimes it's easy to get freaked out in an old West ghost town. Alrighty, so now we're making our way into the heart of the remaining modern-day Vulture City, and I'm going to take you to our first stop on our haunted tour, the first ghost story of the night, the story of the hanging tree, one of our favorites. As we make our way into the town, it's just such a different place at night, but we're starting to see evidence of the Ray Villafane presentations that we're going to be seeing much of tonight. And there it is, the hanging tree, as it's known here at Vulture City. A tree reported to hang 19 men for various crimes, including something called high-grading ore.
When you start a pioneer town out in the middle of nowhere, it doesn't come with a police department. It doesn't come with a newspaper. For a time, the common folk are the judge, jury, and executioners. There are accounts, many of which occurred in Arizona in the 1800s, of vigilante justice, and of course, hangings. It was a thing. That's a fact. Now, the best ghost stories are those tied to a documented history. The next best are those made believable by their historical context. Since it's Halloween, let's play along and entertain that early Vulture City's historical context makes a hanging or two plausible in our minds.
Ah, the hanging tree, one of the essential haunts here at Vulture City Mine. One of my favorites that I've visited over the years and seen this tree in its varying states. Now pretty well manicured. Doesn't look as scary as it used to. So the hanging tree is definitely one of those where you hear a lot of reports of paranormal activity. One that I will state, we've never found any connections historically to any hangings that happened here, but once again, let's think of the plausibility of the historical context of Arizona in the 1860s and just the Old West in general. Vigilantism and hangings were a thing back in those days. Located right next to another reportedly haunted building, the Bordello, the Henry Wickenburg cabin and hanging tree is supposedly the site of many brutal strangulation style hangings for men that were basically ripping off gold ore from the mines and pocketing it. Back before Arizona was a really established place and had more law and order. But yeah, standing out here, it kind of cleared out in this area, and you know, being out and around this cabin, it's a little goosebumpy, I should say. But once again, I've not experienced anything definitive. And men of that time, especially the criminal element, as we've learned in various towns, don't get buried in the nice people's cemetery. Oftentimes they said their bodies were just buried where they died or thrown out into the desert, probably to rot under the sun. But legends state that standing under these folks' feet might be the bodies of those hung for these atrocious crimes they committed in the Old West. All right, let's go into creepy old Henry Wickenburg's 1800s cabin by myself. And you can see, true to the 1800s, there's no electricity in this thing. This is always one of my favorite rooms to come in, and I've never done this one at night. Now, I think that when you read about the legends or hear about the legends, you hear varying versions of probably, if anything, some truth at some point. But one of the ones that's hard for me to reconcile are the ones that kind of suggest that Mr. Wickenburg was sinister and had this tree here in his front yard to hang people and let their bodies rot in the hot Arizona sun. That just doesn't make sense to me. I don't know, why would Mr. Wickenburg want to have rotting bodies outside his front door? But it makes for a good ghost story. So if we're to believe the legends, this should be an extremely, extremely haunted cabin. Hopefully there's enough light coming in through the door here at Henry Wickenburg's cabin. It's pitch black behind me, but I just wanted to stand in here in the complete darkness, and it's creepy. Especially with the hanging tree right outside my door. Imagine if the worst of the legends were true and 19 men actually did die here and there are bodies buried in the ground right outside the door. Right out there. That's the making for a good ghost story, I would say. I've got some assistance here. Thank you, Amy. She's illuminating the room for us so we can see if it's any creepier in lighting we can see. Anything you feel, Amy? You're standing right next to the hanging tree where they said 19 men were killed, strangulated, buried their bodies on the property right where we stand, all for right outside Mr. Wickenburg's front door. Do you ever feel creepy or weird in this particular building or this area?
No.
No? Just the bordello so far?
Yeah. Yeah.
Bordello is something we're going to be visiting here a little bit later, but Amy and I are trying to see if we can commune with the dead. Interwoven inside of all these old legends and gruesome stories and things you hear about this is the more whimsical side of modern day Vulture City, that of the work of Ray Villafane and his studio. Very well known, I would say, here in 2023, and something you've seen many times on our channel. Amy and I can't get enough of this stuff. Let's take a look. The lighter side of Halloween. Every year seems to be a little bit of the same and a little bit different, but you're oftentimes presented with scenes from the Old West, the kinds of things we've heard about today, the people shot and killed, trying to rob the assay office, or getting in drunken brawls at the saloon or the bordello. The bordello that we're going to see here shortly, and all manner of other hijinks and violence. I think Amy and I might consider ourselves aficionados of haunt season and haunted houses, even though we don't frequent them that often. The likes of things like Not Scary Farm, and we love to watch other people's visits of those things. But to me, nothing can beat Vulture City and the kind of setup they have here and what they have going on in this already haunted Old West ghost town. Across from the hanging tree and all that brutality is another building that's reported to have experienced a lot of violence in its time, an 1800s assay office where they used to store some of the gold they were mining out of here. Subject to bandit raids is what I've heard. Now for the 2023 Halloween Spooktacular here, this place is all done up. They do have it lit up, I think, all year round, but you've got pumpkins and hay and lots of whimsical displays here from Ray Villafane. So before we go in there, we need to cleanse our palate with something lighter after that last tale of hanging and brutality and vigilantism. Let's enter this thing here and see if we can find ourselves any evidence of hauntings. And I'll tell you what I've heard about this particular building and its stories. You're looking at an 1800s assay office, complete with pumpkin employees, which is amazing. Testing ore. I always find this building particularly creepy because when it's windy, you hear the roof creak in here. I've been in here many times, and in times of day where I've been the only one in the whole park, and I've been able to explore in here and really contemplate and try to bring myself back to that era. And, you know, I love my haunted history. Even though I'm a skeptic, I'm always open to something paranormal. And this building, there are several stories that I've heard about it, and let me walk you through what I've heard. So of course, an assay office, its function was to test rock and ore to make sure when people were prospecting that there was a good chance that the areas they were gonna dig in would be profitable and remain profitable. So all of this equipment and everything you see in here from that era are furnaces and the implements needed to do that sort of testing. You see our pumpkins there doing a good demonstration of the art of assay. But when you're dealing with a gold mine, some say that human greed and darkness comes with it. Walking around in here, you kind of do just get the feeling that somebody or something's got their eye on you. I think it's not just that superstition human mind is my theory, but undeniably when you're alone at nighttime in a place like this with all the feet that have walked through here and some of the violence that you hear about that could have happened here, mind becomes much more open to suggestions in the dark. Not only was this an assay office, there's a vault where they stored gold bullion, and the legends say that this place was attempted to be raided on multiple occasions, and there were murders that happened in the process. Now, if you watch some of the popular ghost hunting episodes on TV, you may remark a couple people dropped into there and had some experiences in this room. And it makes you wonder when you're standing in it yourself and you understand the age and time period and that historical context once again. Although I can't find documented history around stories like that, the plausibility factor is there. All right, now for the creepiest part, in my opinion, of the assay office. It's this kind of live-in quarters that's so dimly lit. Got a flickering light bulb in here. You see your shadow, the creaking of the floor. All right, I'll just give it a shot over here in the Halloween spirit. Anybody here know a Jimmy Davis? A Mexican Rita? I've heard upstairs, there is an upstairs here. Sometimes we'll hear footsteps. Sometimes they'll hear pebbles being thrown in through windows. Thought I heard a little noise earlier. Is anybody here with us? And although there's activity and people here for Ray's event, it's dark in here. And there's the upstairs to where they say there's ghosts that are up there that you'll hear walking sometimes on the floor, and you'll see dirt coming down from the ceiling, they say. And there's another room back here you just see just so dimly lit. And it helps you transplant yourself back into the 1800s, where candlelight would have been the only way to see. And this is probably indicative of the how bright things would be compared to our modern interior lighting, our LEDs of today. All right, let's leave this creepy, dark area. Hear that creaking? I mean, this is better than any haunted house you could go to at a fair or amusement park, in my opinion. This is the real deal. We're seeking out our own ghosts on this episode. Our next visit on our haunted tour is right next to the doctor's office, a very well-placed bordello. Maybe patients of the doctor, but that's another place that's reported to be haunted, and we'll talk a little bit about that one. But first, let's see what's going on in the doctor's office. Every year there's kind of a slightly different thing going on in here, and this year's is maybe my favorite. I love this guy. And look at his IV. He's taking slime into his veins. And you've got a levitating pumpkin on the bed with a chamber pot below. And then these jolly looking fellows here getting tooth extractions. But a real doctor's office, though, mind you, with real relics from back in the day. Not heard any stories about this doctor's office being haunted per se, but you'd think with some of the painful things that probably went on in here, like tooth extractions without Novocaine, I bet you there's one or two of those in here. You'd think that would cause a haunting. Right, guys? Maybe one of my favorite haunted buildings here is the brothel, the one where I've kind of felt the most creepy vibes. And it has the most creepy mannequins also. Mexican Rita? Oh, that's that freaky look on her face. I wonder if this is Mexican Rita. I've always wondered that. I think, Amy, there's a... looks like the same lady almost here.
I've wondered.
Mexican Rita, of course, is a spirit that's supposed to haunt this old bordello. The one room where Amy has even said she's felt a little creepy. Hello, paying customer here. I'm looking for Mexican Rita. You came highly recommended. Is there a Mexican Rita anywhere here on the premises? I'm short on time. Hoping we can just have a quick date.
I don't know much about the legend of Mexican Rita and what I'm supposed to experience in this particular bordello, but just the thought of bordellos is kind of a creepy thought for me anyway on its own. So I don't know if you need ghosts to make up for the kind of deeds that probably went down in places like this.
All right, unless we something showed up behind me that I didn't see, we kind of struck out here at the bordello again this year. We still have one more location to check out, and this one, I hear, is tied to a real historic documented death.
And now we're gonna enter the workshop of Ray Villafane, where he and his studio do work today. One of my favorite buildings here. I don't know what we're gonna be able to see and what's open, but this part at least is open. There's new stuff I see already. One of my favorites.
Here we are within the heart of the studio here at Villafane Studios in Vulture City, one of my favorite places to come every year and see what's new and what's the same, because a lot of these sites in here are a tradition now for Amy and I at this point.
And each and every year I'm remembering things like this and enjoying the old and the new.
For our finale today, I'm gonna take you guys into the very currently dark, pitch black powerhouse here. The last haunted location where I believe there's very much validity behind the legends, as there's a real death tied to this place.
The death in question is verifiable and was that of one James Clinton Davis, or Jimmy, as his friends and co-workers called him. An article from the Hassayampa Miner, dated Thursday, May the 4th of 1916, summarizes the event best.
A sad occurrence at the Vulture Mill Sunday night resulted in the death of James, or, as he was better known, Jimmy Davis, the son of Mr. and Mrs. A. Davis of Vulture. According to reports, a belt had been thrown off, and Mr. Davis climbed up to replace it. It was looped on the main shaft, and he put one of his arms through a loop to pull the belt down to place. This action tightened the belt on the shaft and rapidly swung the young man around in the air, his body coming in contact with various obstructions which broke practically every bone in his body. The accident occurred about 10 o'clock and he lingered until 3 a.m., when he expired without regaining consciousness. Mr. Davis was very popular with his associates, who mourn his untimely end, he being only 20 years of age.
So Amy and I got here pretty late. Intentionally, and I thought maybe they'd have lights in here, but this is pitch black. So, out of all the places I've been, this is the spookiest, I'd say. All right, I'm gonna have to use my phone as the light going in here. But right off the bat, you can see some of that old industrial strength equipment they used. This is a diesel engine. And maybe the very one responsible for the death of the guy in our tale today. One Jimmy Davis. This is turning out a lot creepier than I even envisioned, Amy, for our episode here in this whole thing, you know, thinking, could this be what ended Mr. Davis's life violently, like it did? Now there's other machines in here also. That's one of the things that I've not been able to validate, is which belt system, which shaft, what piece of equipment. Thought I heard a noise over here. What piece of equipment brought Mr. Davis to his grisly end? You know, these fit the bill for what I would think that would have the capability of doing something like that to a human being. You can see an old, I don't know if it's a fire truck, it's got wooden spokes, whatever it is. An old relic from a time not remembered and more heavy industrial equipment. All right, Amy, you're leaving me out here, right? I'm gonna go in here by myself.
It's time for a lockdown.
It is time for a lockdown. It's a different thing when you're going in on your own and you don't have anybody with you. So, all right, guys, you wanna come with me? It's creepy when you watch that Ghost Adventures episode. I'm almost positive this is the powerhouse that was in the video, and you see the reaction of a former owner of this place. And this used to just be left in arrested decay. There wasn't any restoration back in the day. These things were crumbling back like 10, 20 years ago. And the guy seemed genuine in his fear and said that he was in here. There used to be a lot more equipment on the walls. You could say they removed a lot. There were fuse boxes and all this other stuff. And I remember miners' clothes being held up there. But he said the voice was chilling to him, the set me free or something along those lines. And then you know the story of Jimmy Davis and connect those dots, and who knows? What do you guys think? Well, folks, it's that sad time where we have to part ways from our spooky Halloween 2023 adventure here at Vulture City Mine. Hope you had fun with us. We will be back with another regular adventure next week, so keep tuning in. Until then, bye-bye.